I'm going to talk about the album Kaya, which follows Exodus. It's interesting because I said in the earlier lecture that many of the tunes that were on Kaya were actually recorded at the same time as the songs that that happened to be on Exodus. And all of this work was done while Marley was in exile in England. And he was shuttling between England and the United States, but he never went to Jamaica at all, because of course it was incredibly dangerous in Jamaica, and the violence had continued. Marley's mother was living in Wilmington, Delaware, and then Marley would buy a home that same year. This would be 76, 77. We 77 actually. Marley would buy a home in Florida, in Miami, and his mother would move there with him. And it's while he was in Florida, in Miami, that he did some of the other tracks, some of the final tracks for Kaya. But he was shuttling between the UK and Florida. Part of the reason he was moving back and forth as well was that some months before they got on the tour for Exodus, Exodus had been incredibly successful, and Marley had done a European-based tour of Exodus, which was hugely popular and hugely successful. Marley had been playing football, soccer, in Paris, and had injured his toe. He was seen by the hotel doctor who treated the toe. The toe's damage was what would you call a toe jam, that is, that he was kicking the ball, it's his right foot, and his toe got jammed, and the toenail got jammed and got badly damaged. So they cleaned it up and essentially pulled out the nail and really destroyed any capacity for that nail to grow again. But Marley was experiencing, or through the tour, a lot of pain in the toe, and it wasn't healing. And so he eventually decided to see, to get some treatment for it in England, and went to some of the best doctors there. And it was then, that was the time when it was first diagnosed as being cancerous. I don't think this, not I don't think, we know this was not common knowledge by anybody. In fact, for many people, when Marley collapsed in Central Park in 1981, and the news came that he had cancer, this was the first inclination that we had. But now, in retrospect, what we do know is that Marley had heard that first diagnosis of cancer in 1977, and it was initially proposed that he amputate the toe. It would affect his balance and so on, but the feeling was that if they amputated the toe, he would then heal and be able to go on the tour. The reason Marley did not amputate the toe is up for much conjecture. In a very interesting talk by Neville Garrick some years ago, where he was doing a series of oral histories about his life with Bob Marley. Neville Garrett was the artist and art director for the Marley team, and a very close friend of Bob Marley, and traveled with Bob Marley. Garrick basically sums it up as suggesting that as a Rasta, there was some anxiety, some concern, and resistance to the idea of losing a limb, the wholeness of the body being everything. So Marley then went to Florida on the advice of Don Taylor, his manager, to have a second opinion, and they gave a second opinion. It's not clear from all records whether they also diagnosed it as cancer, although some people close to the family, a couple of nurses, said it was still understood to be a cancerous toe. However, they hadn't recommended an amputation, but instead what they did was cleaned it up that is really quite dramatic and intrusive cleanup. And a graft was taken from the back of Marley's thigh and used to cover the toe. And then Marley spent some time recovering. And during that time, he was doing some final work on Kaya. It is, when we look back at that moment, it was the beginning of the cancer in his body, the melanoma, which would eventually spread. And what is remarkable is that Marley continued to tour very close to the day he collapsed. And sometimes watching his performances, the sheer energy and the charisma and power of those performances, one would never have guessed that he was actually, he was struggling. I mean, in other words, the disease was running rampant in his body. By the time he collapsed, it had traveled, metastasized, gone to his brain and other parts of the body. Kaya would be the album that would follow Exodus. Exodus had tremendous success. Some of the accusations, maybe or suggestions and so on, is that Kaya is the softer album. Kaya was sort of a kind of album. I think the inclination towards a commercial feel is there, but I think all the elements that we think of Kaya as a roots album are also there. It's an album that has a strong dub bass. It's an album that depends on the horns in ways that Marley hadn't for as much, we'd say, for Exodus. But it's certainly there, strong horn lines. And yet, interestingly also, some of the songs on Kaya were songs that he had recorded with Lee Scratch Perry in 69 and 70. And these were interesting recordings because they were very, very much in the spirit of Perry, who was incredibly imaginative and an eccentric artist who has had a very peculiar and complex kind of spirituality, but incredible genius as a engineer and as a composer of music through electronic means. Songs like Kaya, Is This Love, Sun Is Shining, all of these songs are reprisals. These are songs that have been reprised from the late 60s and early 70s and brought back into this album. The first side of the album is a gentle side. And really, the truth is, Kaya contains some of the last love songs that Bob Marley would record. Is This Love, Sun Is Shining is a love song, although it's a deeply philosophical song as well. And then She's Gone, which I think is really one of Marley's great love songs. I have a great affinity and care for this album. It really opened my eyes to Bob Marley. It opened my eyes to the poetry of Bob Marley. I grew up listening to Bob Marley and learning about Bob Marley, but Kaya really arrested me. I was a teenager listening to this music and thinking that I was having the very same challenges and pleasures of poetic analysis with Marley's lyrics as I was having with T.S. Eliot, as I was having, interestingly enough, with Gerald Manley Hopkins and so on, that I was doing at school. I began to find ways to apply that kind of thinking to Marley's lyrics, which I hadn't experienced with any other artist. And so we get the first side of the album, Easy Skanking, Take It Easy. It begins with this sort of, these are the songs that sort of make you connect Marley to the easygoing life, the cool and gently life, and of course the life of the drug user. The first lyric is, "Excuse me while I light my spliff. Oh God, I gotta take a lift. From reality, I just can't drift. That's why I'm staying with this rift. Take it easy, got to take it easy." And then he says, "Herb for my wine. Herb is marijuana. Honey for my strong drink." For the Rasta man, the herb is a herb. It's a natural product, and it's not a drug. And so he juxtaposes herb as a natural healing agent versus wine, which is an alcoholic agent. And there is no question that Marley is making the case that why do we happily legalize alcohol despite all the damage that it causes? And of course, marijuana is illegal. It certainly was illegal at that time. So he says, herb for my wine, honey for my strong drink, herb for my wine. It's a very light song, and this is how the album opens. Musically, though, it's the high end is there. There's a strong sort of bass riding through it, but the pacing is quite steady and quite gentle. So then we move from easy skanking, and skanking is to dance in Jamaica, to Kaya. And Kaya begins, wake up and turn eye loose, for the rain is falling. Gotta have Kaya now, gotta have Kaya now, for the rain is falling. I feel so high, I even touch the sky above the falling rain. I feel so good in my neighborhood, so here I come again. I've gotta have Kaya now. I've gotta have Kaya now. And that there, Marley's leap into the imagination. I mean, if we think of the way that he pictures the situation, Kaya, of course, is marijuana. Kaya is the other word for marijuana. So I got to have Kaya is a clear statement that I want this herb. And then celebrating it, he says, I feel so high, I even touch the sky above the falling rain. And that's a very interesting image, because of course the image is, you know, it's funny to say I've entered the stratosphere. But actually what he's talking about is the calming nature of marijuana for him to rise above the storminess, the cloudiness, the misty, you know. And it's very interesting, because what we see in these lyrics is Marley using nature and his understanding of nature and his engagement with nature more than anywhere else in his entire body of work, where in Easy Skanking, Kaya, Sun is Shining. In these songs, he references the sky. In Misty Morning, he references the weather. He references landscape. He references the ecological world. And his relationship with the world is one in which he's really reaching to arrive at a sense of sublimation, a sense of being above the falling rain. And then at the same time, I feel so good in my neighborhood, so here I come again. I've got to have Kaino. I've got to have Kaino. One doesn't have to make too hard a stretch to imagine that for Marley, this period of exile was also a period that where he needed to be replenished, and a period in which I think he associated his ability to meditate, to smoke, and to eat good food, and to live among family as a restorative time after the quite tumultuous period of the assassination attempt. Which brings us to these two love songs. Well, I'll say one explicit love song, which is This Love. And Is This Love is a question. The refrain is this love, is this love, is this love that I'm feeling, is this love that I'm feeling. The interesting thing about this lyric is, you know, I talked about how what Marley's love songs were trying to do or were achieving. And it's interesting because, of course, Marley's love songs are rooted in the Jamaican landscape, and he's trying to contain them within the Jamaican landscape. But he's also, there are songs that speak to, that do not sort of reach for an external idea of what is loving and what is beautiful, but instead tries to locate those things within the Jamaican landscape and within the Jamaican imagery and the Jamaican understanding of the world and how one sees themselves. So then, if we think of the lyrics themselves, Marley begins, "I want to love you and treat you right. I want to love you every day and every night. We'll be together with a roof right over our head. We'll share the shelter of my single bed. We'll share the same room, or Jah provide the bread." One of the important sort of ways in which I've come to engage Marley's music, and not just Marley's music, but reggae music, is to discover in this music this capacity for it to be to be multiple things at the same time. And I think it's such a crude summation of what I mean, but if we think of music as carrying certain thematic interests or having some certain functions in the world and in society, and if we think of music as categorizable, there is a sense in which reggae music, and certainly the music of Bob Marley, seeks to defy a kind of categorization by simply being a complex lyric sensibility that allows the individual to live in society and to speak in society, but still to be an individual, to have an individual narrative. This is something that has made us understand the power of the blues and made us understand the power of jazz. And I think it's the same thing that makes us understand the power of reggae music and certainly the power of Bob Marley's music. Because if you think about it, if we think of these genres, these sort of ways in which we categorize music, there's spiritual music, and people will say, well, this music is spiritual or religious music, and it falls into a certain kind of category. And in many ways, we try to sort of keep it in that category. There's a dynamic relationship that is articulated between God and man and all of these kinds of things, and God and woman, God and the universe, that connection. But then, so that's one kind of song. And then there's the political song, which again is a political song that speaks to society, that challenges society, that comments on the inequities in society, that comments on the need for freedoms and so on and so forth. So we sort of categorize this. This is a political singer. And then we've got the love singer, the love song, the idea that the love song is a song form that emphasizes love and so on. And we know that that's a whole genre. A lot of pop music is that way. Well, one of the interesting things about music in America was that those categories seem to hold up, where we associate certain artists with certain things, and yet when they moved doing to other things, we call them shifting their focus and shifting their direction. That's those strict categories are interestingly defied when we think of R&B music in the late 1960s, where R&B music is really taking the feel and the texture and sometimes the rhetorical position of gospel and secularizing it by turning it into the articulations of love songs. So you can see why artists like Aretha Franklin, Otis Redding, and the whole slew of them had strong church roots and church understanding. Many of them came out of gospel groups, and then they moved into soul. And for them, it was an explicit shift. For them, they were accused of, in fact, backsliding into soul music. What we get in reggae, and certainly what we get in Bob Marley, is a complete dismantling of those categories, and that in a single song, in a single moment, we can get all three and more elements: love and sensuality, politics, spirituality, all in a single song, and done seamlessly and with complete nuance, and yet at the same time fully lyrical, in the sense that it is exploring the very distinctive vision and experience of the artist. And Is This Love is a case in point. Because if you think about it, "I want to love you and treat you right," which is a straight lyrical articulation. This is a love song. "I want to love you every day and every night." we'll be together with a roof right over our heads. That immediate move to the roof is an economic articulation. It's a statement that says, I will protect you, but I will protect you because we live in a space in which the protection is necessary. That it is necessary for the songwriter to actually point to the need for a roof over our heads. And then he says, we'll share the shelter, which this is a beautiful image, by the way. We'll share the shelter of my single bed. The shelter is calling a bed a shelter is a tender way to talk about protection, to talk about caring and so on. But it's a single bed. And there is an economic articulation, because of course this is an artist, this is a singer, this is the lover who is saying, I don't have a lot, all I have is a single bed, but I want to love you and treat you right. And then he says, we'll share the same room, not mansion, not so on and so forth. So the room being shared is a small room with a single bed. And then Jah will provide the bread. So not only are we getting the political, and I would say the social commentary, but then who is going to provide the bread? It will be Jah who provide the bread. And yet, the song is not, this is love that I'm feeling. It is a song that says, given these circumstances that I've described in the verse, is this love? It's rhetorical, because he's saying it must be love, because what I want to do for you is my expression and my articulation of love. Marley, like I said, rarely sort of said, I love you, all right? Marley would say here, I want to love you, and I want to treat you right. I want us to share this space and this world. Reminds us a lot of No Man Cry in that way. Is this love, is this love, is this love? And then he says, oh yes, I know, yes, I know, yes, I know now. And then, I am willing and able, so I'll throw my cards on your table. And that's again a metaphor from life, from the games that you play. I throw my cards on the table, meaning that I will expose myself and I'll express myself openly. Of course, it depends on what game you're playing. If it's dominoes, throwing your cards on the table is not saying I'm opening up, or it's actually saying I've won. And then I want to love you and treat you right, and it goes on to the end. Is This Love is an incredibly popular song, and it's one of the songs that for a period I think had reached number 9 on record charts and so on. The next song that we can talk about is Sun Is Shining. Sun Is Shining is an old song. Sun Is Shining was first produced, again, with the Lee Scratch Perry Bob Marley combination. What was it? In the late 1960s, early 1970s, the two recordings of it, and it, very different versions of it. But lyrically, it's a very interesting song. Again, feel good. Sun is shining. Weather is sweet. Makes you want to move your dancing feet. And what I'm getting at is, again, always remember that when Marley is in this mode, he never loses sight of the spiritual necessity to articulate experience. And so we lift our heads and give Jah praises. We lift our heads and give Jah praises. This is another song, another of those naming songs, those numbering songs. Marley enjoyed numbering songs by days of the week, songs about work and so on and so forth. And so in this song we get Monday morning, here I can, here I am, want you to know just if you can, Tuesday evening where I stand, Wednesday morning, tell myself the new day is dawning, get on the rise, the new day Wednesday morning, tell myself a new day is rising, get on the rise, a new day is dawning. Really interesting play on words there. And then, of course, it ends with Saturday evening. I want you to know just where I stand. And then in the middle of that song, there's this great metaphor. And again, I think some of his really most lyric writing, and some would say literary writing, but some of the most lyric images are there. When the morning gathers the rainbow, what a great construction. When the morning gathers the rainbow, I want you to know that I am a rainbow too. So to the rescue, here I am. I want you to know, just if you can, where I stand. And then we move into the spiritual moment. He says, we lift our heads and give Jah praises. We lift our heads and give Jah praises. The sun is shining, the weather is sweet. It's pure joy and a pure sensibility, but the sensibility is never loses sight of where the source of that joy is, where the source of that hope and possibility is. And in this song also, we see Marley scatting a bit. Because of course, you know, if I remember, you come near to the end of the song and he says, awake from your sleep and slumber. Today could be your lucky number. Awake from your sleep and slumber. Today could be your lucky number. Sun is shining. Weather is sweet. In these songs, I think we see a great deal of dialogue between Marley and the I-3. Sometimes in many of these songs, he allows them to have full passages where they sing as well, the I-3. And this is a very interesting way in which Marley then increases the way in which they move from backup singers to sort of leading the music. I think Marley had developed this understanding of it, particularly from performing, from being on stage, and create and watching the audience enjoy the dynamic between himself and these three incredible singers, these three women. Satisfy My Soul is the last song on this album, this side of the album, the first side. And it's a straight love song. Again, another of those songs that was recorded several years before that, 10 years before that, really recorded several 10 years before that. One of the interesting things to also remember, what Neville Garrick is talking about Marley's writing approach and how he wrote songs. Marley never actually wrote lyrics down so much as he just kept rehearsing songs over and over again and kept changing the lyrics until he felt he had the right phrasing and so on. And so Garrick would say that very often Marley would have written many of his songs years before, or started to build those songs, and then over time, as he's getting close to putting them on record, he starts to fine-tune them by just repeating them and doing that. There's an interesting recording of Marley actually doing that to one song, and it runs for over an hour, where he's just going over the same song again and again and again. This was just recorded in the studio, and every verse keeps changing slightly. And then finally there's this magical moment where you suddenly realize this is the song that was finally recorded, and you've watched him edit it in each time, each rotation. It's a beautiful thing to witness and to experience. Satisfy My Soul is another of those songs that is incredibly popular. It has that sort of poppy feel and so on and so forth. And you probably have heard it, because it's played a lot on elevators and other places like that. The lyric is, oh, please don't you rock my boat, because I don't want my boat to be rocking. I'm telling you that I like it like this. I like it like this to keep it steady. And you should know by now that I like it like this. You satisfy my soul. Every little action produces a reaction. Can't you see what you've done for me? I'm happy inside all of the time. When we bend a new corner, you make me feel like a sweepstake winner. When I meet you around the corner, you make me feel like a sweepstake winner. Oh child, can't you see? Why don't you believe me? Oh darling, darling, I'm calling. Can't you see? Well, won't you believe me? Oh darling, darling, I'm calling. You satisfy my soul. You satisfy my soul. You satisfy my soul. And it's a very simple lyric. The song is that you, the woman, in this case, in his dialogue, you satisfy my soul. When you hold me tight, you make me feel all right. And when you hold me tight, you make me feel all right. And of course, he keeps repeating it. So this is Marley in the begging mode. This is the Marley that we know from the earlier songs where he's pleading, right? And he's not just pleading, but he's saying, you, if you allow me, then you make me feel like a sweepstake winner. And he even says, can't you see, why won't you believe me? I'm calling, calling, can't you see, why don't you believe me? I'm calling, calling, oh darling, darling, I'm calling, calling. And then, of course, that image of when I meet you around the corner, sort of meeting around the corner is almost a teenager's kind of articulation, because you know, in growing up in Jamaica at that time, of course, you, if you had a girlfriend or boyfriend situation, you didn't want your parents to know that you had a boyfriend. And so you would meet them around the corner. So that idea of me, but of course he's a grown man at this point, but he's using the language of youthful love, and love that is a bit taboo, but one that he's able to articulate and express his feelings and desires for this woman. So if we think about it in the first half of the album, if we think about it as a whole, we realize that the album does have this incredible light feel to it in terms of themes. And it is the first part is reaching for satisfaction. It's reaching for even escape, I think. I think it's fair to say that there's a kind of reach for escape. And in that reach for escape, the music carries that feel as well. But at the same time, what we see happening is that it is also still rooted in a spiritual sensibility and a spiritual understanding. And it is a different kind of feel from Exodus, right? Exodus has its regality and so on and so forth, and Exodus has these jam tunes. I think Marley chose to have this feel here. So when we get to the second half of the album, then we start to realize that there is more to it than just feel-good moments. In fact, the second half of the album is not full of happiness and giddiness and joy, but it's full of real questions. So the first song on the second half of the album is She's Gone. She's Gone is a love song, but is it a love song? It's a song of loss. It's a song, it's a breakup song, but even more than that, because a breakup song sounds almost juvenile, but it's a song of rupture in a relationship. And we can speculate about all of this, who this song is about. But it is clear that Marley has identified a very particular moment in a relationship where things have fallen apart, and he does something quite unique to even Marley himself. Because I think in this song, Marley shows the first hint in his songs, well, not the first hint, but one of the second moments where, or third moments where Marley starts to imagine writing with great empathy for the person that he's singing about, the woman that he's singing about. We get a sense of that in the emotional Johnny Was, where, you know, which from the Rastaman Vibration album, woman holds her head and cries because her son has been shot dead in the strike. And then he says, explaining to her, I was passing by, she complained, she complained and she cried. There's a conversation with a real person in that song. And in this song, we get this weird conversation where he quotes her and she starts to speak in the song. And I think that's what has happened in there. And that is one of the powers of the moment. And yet it's a song being addressed to somebody specific. And the person he's addressing is his children. And so the thought is that Marley is just using children as a kind of generic term for the people that he preaches to, the people that he sings to. And Marley was known to, as many reggae artists are known to sort of refer to the audience, refer to the listener as, oh, children. But Marley here seems to be speaking about, oh, my children, if you see me crying, my woman is gone. If you see me, my woman is gone. It's the children. who she's the mother of. So the lyric is, my woman is gone. My woman is gone. She had left me a note hanging on my door. She said she couldn't take it anymore. Then the next line is, the pressures around me just couldn't see. She felt like a prisoner who needs to be free. Marley says, there was so much pressure around me that I could not see that she felt like a prisoner who needs to be free. Something has happened in Marley for him to understand why she's left him. Marley never says she shouldn't have left. Marley never complains about her doing any wrong in it. He says, it was me. I could not see the pressures around me. Couldn't see. She felt like a prisoner who needs to be free. Fools have tried. Wise men have failed. Oh, listen to me, honey. Life could never be another jail. So he agrees with her. She says, I felt like a prisoner who needs to be free. And he says, fools have tried. Wise men have failed. Oh, listen to me, honey. Life could never be another jail. And he says, still we know now, we never see smoke. And there's something funny going on here. You never see smoke without fire. And everyone you see has their heart's desire. And this is where Marley starts to show a bit of an edge, almost Dylan-esque in it. Because at first we think Marley is empathizing completely with her. But there's a hint that her departure is not just because she feels entrapped, but because he said, you never see smoke without fire. He's almost accusing her of having a feeling or having been doing something else that is driving her away. The hint is, of course, she's going to somebody else. He says, still we know now, you never see smoke without fire, and everyone you see has their heart's desire. And then he laments, she's gone, she's gone, she's gone, she's gone, yeah. Oh, my children, if you see me cry, my woman is gone. Next verse, he says, she made it through the exit. She just couldn't make it. She made it through the exit. She just couldn't take it. And oh, my children, if you see me crying, my woman is gone. If you see me, if you see me, if you see me, if you see me crying, she's gone, she's gone, she's gone, yes. Oh, my children, if you see me crying, my woman is gone. I love the drama of that moment. So now it's not all fun and games. We know the history, of course, of this time. Marley's relationship with Cindy Brakesman will eventually wane a bit. Marley's still dealing with a woman, a wife, who essentially has moved along. She stayed married, she's still with the band and so on and so forth, but she's also had other relationships because, of course, she recognizes what has happened. So it's a very complex situation. But Marley has the ability to write this song about loss and about a woman who says that she feels like a prisoner who needs to be free. In the next verse, in the next song, we get Misty Morning. Misty Morning was a new song. Neville Garrick, but Marley's friend, describes it as a song that he wrote began to write in Delaware, Wilmington, Delaware, on a cloudy day. So we have these sort of literal moments of epiphany and revelation, and then songwriter starts to write. Garrick says he just remembers Marley starting off with that lyric, "Misty morning, don't see no sun. I know you're out there somewhere having fun. There is one mystery I just can't express. Why you give your more to receive your less. The power of philosophy flows through my head, light like a feather, heavy as lead." I have to say that when I started to pay attention to those lyrics as a 17, 18-year-old, I was completely blown away by this. I was blown away because each of these cones, these little epigrams, the tiny little gems of wisdom Marley strings together, ending with, "the power of philosophy flows through my head, light like a feather, heavy as lead." It becomes meta in its construction because, of course, Marley says, I know what I'm saying, as it seems disjointed, and I know what I'm saying is abstraction. And I know what I'm saying is philosophically constructed. And he says, the power of philosophy flows through my head. It's light as a feather. Light, it seems like something light and trivial, but it's also deep, heavy as lead. So, Misty Morning, and he says, I know you're out there somewhere having fun. That who this person is a very interesting question, but we will see that later on in the song. I know you're out there somewhere having fun. And then the big mystery he does, he can't express, is why you give your more to receive your less. In other words, he says, why is it a kind of self-concern? Why do I keep giving more only to receive less, right? And he says this is a constant mystery to him. Why we do that, why he himself does that, right? And then he says, the power of philosophy flows through my head like a feather heavy as lead. And he says, time has come. I want you to straighten out my tomorrow. And so who is he addressing? Misty Morning? Or he's addressing somebody else, or is it a prayer? I want you to straighten out my tomorrow. This is the heart and the finish of the song, and the quest is to have the tomorrow straightened out. Tomorrow is, he's worried about tomorrow. So while we have in the first half of the album this reaching for fun and so on and so forth, in the second half, my woman has gone, and then I'm dealing with Misty Morning, and I want somebody to help straighten out my tomorrow. There's a beginning, there's a thread of doubt, of sorrow, and a kind of a kind of melancholy that runs through it, right? And musically, it still has this kind of feel to it. I think it's just worth even just playing a snippet of it, of just what it sounds like. Slow pace. There we go. So there's that, just that energy still underneath all of that. The next song is Crisis. And Crisis now starts to remind us that he's still dealing with this assassination attempt. And in fact, the last three songs, Crisis, Running Away, and Time Will Tell us that Marley is wrestling with that memory, that experience. Not only the actual experience, but now he's thinking about it. He has some distance, and he's asking questions of what does it mean? Crisis begins, they say the sun don't shine. They say the sun will shine, it shines for all. But in some people's world, it never shines at all. They say love is a stream that will find its course. But some people think life is a dream, so they are making matters worse. They say that the sun shines for all, but in some people's world, it never shines at all. Misty morning, don't see no sun. I know you're out there somewhere having fun. Sun is shining, the weather is sweet, but sometimes the sun doesn't shine for all. They say love is a stream that will find its course. That's what they say. But some people think life is a dream, so they're making matters worse. So what he's juxtaposing is optimism, platitudes, but the facing the reality of it. But no matter what the crisis is, he says, and this is very interesting. So what he's described is not beautiful. It's doubtful. Yet what happens in the next line is, no matter what the crisis is, no matter what the crisis is, we're doing it, give Jah. We're going to give Jah all the thanks and praises. We're giving it, giving Jah all the thanks and praises. It's a spiritual song. It's a song that says, no matter what the crisis is, we're going to thank God. We're going to give Jah all the thanks and praises. Next verse says, so much has been said and so little been done. That's if you doubt what Marley's getting at, then you can see it here. He says they're killing the people, and they're having so much fun. Killing the people, they're having their fun. They just want to be the leaders in the house of the rising sun. But no matter what the crisis is, no matter what the crisis is, we're giving it. Give Jah all the thanks and praises. They're killing the people and having fun. Something terribly sardonic about that. And they want to be the leaders in the house of the rising sun. So this is the broader political space where somebody wants to run things completely and in the process kill people. He says, live it up, live it up, live it up, live it up. Give Jah all the thanks and praises. No matter what the crisis is. No matter what the crisis is. We give Jah all the thanks and praises. And then in the end, he says, why do we give Jah all the thanks and praises? He says, his mercies endureth forever. Children, come on and give Jah. Give Jah all the thanks and praises. Oh, children, come on and give Jah. Give Jah all the thanks and praises. You know, there's a very interesting thing that happens throughout this album. Of course, Marley also gives credit to other people. So now we get to Running Away. Two more songs to deal with, Running Away. And Running Away is a peculiar song because I could do a whole lecture on Running Away because I think it's one of Marley's most brilliant songs stylistically and just in terms of what he's achieving in it. First of all, it's uniquely interesting because this is the song that Marley actually writes about his exile. He literally is writing about and singing about him leaving Jamaica and going into exile. But what he creates is a drama. He creates a drama in this song. And the drama he achieves by pitting himself as the object of ridicule against the choric voice of the I-3 singing, you're running and you're running and you're running away. It's accusatory. So what you have to understand is Marley is creating a drama between them, and then he answers, you're running away, but you can't run away from yourself, he says. It's almost a conversation. They're saying, you're running and you're running and you're running away, which is the accusation. Jamaicans are saying, why are you running away? And he says, but you can't run away from yourself. In other words, he's saying, it's impossible for me to run away from myself because the truth is that I remain who I am. Marley is so desperate to say, I remain who I am. I haven't betrayed us. I haven't betrayed my country, but I remain who I am. But then they keep saying it. You're running and running and you're running away, but you can't run away from yourself. You can't run away from yourself. And then the accusations continue. You must have done something wrong. Said you must have done something wrong. Why you can't find where you belong? And it's interesting because of Marley is repeating the things that he's heard being said about him and putting it into the song. Of course, that's the question. Why are you running away? Yes, they tried to shoot you, but why did they try to kill you? Did you do something wrong? Were you involved in the CIA? Were you involved in the politics? And he's saying, this is what they're saying to me. You must have done something wrong. Why you can't find where you belong? Normally, in the first reading and listening to this song, I thought Marley's just singing about. And there's that element in it, that just saying to people, if you find yourself running, maybe you need to examine yourself to see what you've done wrong and so on. And that's fair. But I think Marley's doing something else here. I think he's actually speaking to himself. And I think he's enacting the drama of him being the object of gossip and accusations. And he says, so the question then is why you can't find the place where you belong. And we don't know this until the very end. Then he starts to speak. He says, every man thinketh his burden is the heaviest. Heaviest. Every man thinketh his burden is the heaviest. The heaviest. And then he says, but who feels it knows it? This is his rejoinder. His answer is, every man thinks his burden is the heaviest. But the person who feels it knows it. And he's saying, I know why I left. I know why I left. And you can't judge me because you don't know what I'm carrying. And this song moved me so much because I think in that moment I began to go, wow. Because you're listening to an artist pouring his heart out and saying, you don't know what I've been through. You don't know what I'm going through. Who feels it knows it. And then, in this great moment near the end of the song, almost as if he's ad-libbing, but it's in verse, it rhymes, but he's just talking. He says, no, no, no. Don't say that. I'm not running. I've got to protect my life and I don't want to live in no strife. It's better to live on the housetop than to live in a house full of confusion. But I made my decision and I left you. And now you're coming to tell me that I'm running away. It's not true. So in that moment, Marley then gives us the clue to the song. Now you are coming to tell me that I'm running away. He says it's not true. Don't say that. And this happens just at the tail end of the song. No, 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 don't say that. I've got to protect my life. That's why I left. And I don't want to live in no strife. I don't want to live in a strife of political violence in this country. And then he uses a quote from the Proverbs. He says, it's better to live on the housetop than to live in a house full of confusion. So I made my decision and I left you. So he did leave and he's left them. He's talking to the people of Jamaica. They're talking to the people who have accused them of leaving. And now you're coming to tell me, he says, that I'm running away. It's not true. It's not true, he repeats himself. It's not true. You couldn't say this. It's not true. I think it's just wonderful the way that Marley brings that in to the end. Now, there's a live performance of Marley singing the song, and he never gets into that. In fact, he never gets into that section. He just keeps it on the top level. So this is, I think, in this recorded version, it's one of the most intimate and vulnerable moments in the whole body of Marley's work. One of them. There are several of those. And especially we get more of that broken, vulnerable self in the next two albums that we'll be looking at. Where Marley is allowing himself to doubt. Marley is allowing himself to succumb, to fall into the mercy of God in such beautiful ways. This is Running Away, and I'll just go straight to the end. I watch the conversation. You must have done something you don't want nobody to know about. You must have done something wrong. Yes, you must have done something wrong. Why you can't tell where you belong. He's talking to himself, and there's something so compelling about that. Listen to this. Now, don't say that, because I'm not running away. I've got to protect my life, and I don't want to live with no strife. It's better to live in the house stuff than to live in a house full of confusion. So I made my decision, and I left you, and now you're coming to tell me that but it's not true. You shouldn't say that. It's just stunning, stunning, but really important work. And so we end with Time Will Tell. Time Will Tell is a song that I think helps us to see the psychological state of Marley at this time. Marley's claim in Time Will Tell is, Jah will never give the power to a bald head. Run, come, crucify the dread. Time alone, time will tell. You think you're in heaven, but you're living in hell. This is like heathen from Exodus. He's addressing those who try to come and kill him. And he's reaching in faith to say, God would never give the power to this bald head who has come to crucify me, or the dread, or all God's people, or all the people who they attack. But he says, time will tell. You think you're in heaven, but you're living in hell. It's a curse. He says, back them up, not your brother, not the brothers. Meaning, don't lock the brothers up, but the ones who set them up. Time alone, or time will tell, you think you're in heaven, but you're living in hell. What does he mean? He says, take it out on the people, not the people who did the action. Because those are his brothers, he says. But not them, but the ones who set them up to do this. Time alone, or time will tell. You think you're in heaven, but you're living in hell. And then, here's a moment that if you're a Marley fan or to somebody who's interested in Marley music, student, it's one of the weirdest stretches of lyrics that on the album, Bob Marley's lyrics are written on the album. In the back of Kaya is written there, many of his albums. There's a spot in this song that it's not transcribed on the album. I don't think anybody knows what Marley was singing in that moment, like explicitly. Neville Garrett talks about it in an interesting way, because he doesn't account for that. And I've been doing some research to try and find out what is happening. I mean, one can decipher, and I think some people have done some valiant work in deciphering some of these lyrics, but although they sort of move into clarity after a moment. But I think what Neville Garrick says is that what happened to Marley is that Marley, he said they were going to the studio. He was the keeper of the lyrics. He kept some of the lyrics that Marley would use when he went into the studio after he's composed and everything like that. Garrick was the one who wrote them down. And then Marley was in the studio trying to record this song. And he says to Garrick, he says, where are the script? Where's the book of lyrics? And Garrick realized he had left it in the house. And he says, I forgot it. And Marley says, all right, let's just keep going. And so it seems as if, and so Garrick then describes the lyric itself that he kept. And I think I wrote this down. And he suggests that the song was much longer, right? And upon the cross, we have paid the price. Some have loved and some have sacrificed. These are the lyrics that Marley actually said was going to be in the song. And it just goes on. There are a few lyrics and so forth, but nothing explains the silent moment in it. And he does point out that on the album, it does end with "to be continued." The truth is that there was more to the song than was finally recorded. Yet, I don't think so. I think when Marley and the rest of the producers listened to the recording, they felt this was the way that the song should go. So, what are those mystery words? Well, there is a moment in that song where one has the sense that there's a line that actually carries through and makes sense despite the challenge. He says, I've seen you throw a man to the ground, and he says, I've seen you take a man's pride. And then he says, on my sycamore tree, saw that freedom tree. I saw you settle the score, children weep no more, children weep no more. And that's the best we can do. There's some suggestion of being thrown to the ground, witnessing these hard things. And then on my sycamore tree, the sycamore tree is very famous from the New Testament. This is the tree that Nicodemus climbed to try and see Jesus. It has symbolic resonance and so on and so forth. But he says, from that tree, I saw my freedom tree. And I saw you try to settle the score, but children, weep no more. Weep no more, children, weep no more. But the core of the song is, Jah will never give the power to the bald head. Run, come, crucify the dread. Time alone, or time would tell. You think you're in heaven, but you're living in hell. I think this is transitional music, music that transitions us into the later Bob Marley. Marley becomes very clearly political, writes about Zimbabwe, writes about Africa Unite. He writes about these things, but he also writes about his faith and his dependence on Jah. If Jah didn't love us, would I be alive today? Would I be around to say, give thanks and praises? So I think I'll just wrap this up by suggesting that Kaya is an album that some people denigrate and just simply say it's one of his the albums that they find least appealing. But I think it's one of his more revealing albums, one of his more touching albums, and an album that means a tremendous amount to me. I think it's hard to describe it as his greatest album, but I think it's one of the fine albums. And it musically, it's a very, very beautiful album. But it is a different posture of Marley, a kind of tender is not the word, but a more vulnerable side. And the vulnerability comes in the questioning, in the ability to ask questions and to reflect his own sense of being in exile. Marley would not go back to Jamaica until he goes back for the Great Peace Concert. And it's a triumphant return, but it's also bittersweet in retrospect, because of course we are now dealing with a Marley that is on a trajectory towards his death. He has cancer, it's in his body, and he's touring, and he knows he has this disease. He's taking medication for it. But I don't think he knows it's going to kill him. This is Time Will Tell. The rhythm and the drums, that's the sound of the Rasta drum. Great lament. I think it's very interesting that the entire backing track of this album, of this song actually, is a male voice, easily probably Marley's own backing voice. There's an isolation, there's a sense that he's alone. There we go. Don't go after the brothers, but the ones who set them up. Time, old time will tell. So that's it, Kaya. Just a quintessential album, showing us Marley's range and showing us that Marley is an artist of varied tempo, temperance, feelings, and ideas, and just contains some of the more beautiful, beautiful songs that Marley has ever written. So we'll stop there. Our next album will, of course, I think it will be. It'll be Africa Unite, I think. That'll be the album. Cheers.